That movie was, I believe, started in 98 and issued and released in 2001. Mm-hmm. And he was born in 1937. Yeah, so he was.
So that here is a man who, like at Gloria Swanson in Sunset Boulevard, he's going on his looks that are now aging.
Well,
and you do point, sort of describe him as quite a vain man.
Well, he would say the same thing. You know, he was very self-deprecating. He sort of mastered the art of self-deprecation. He would, before you could deprecate him, he would deprecate himself. Okay. And he would say, "I'm the vainest actor in Hollywood," or you haven't met anyone who's vain until you've met me," things like that.
Yeah.
But, you know, a lot of leading men are vain. Warren was, because he was so smart, he was able to lift vanity to, get almost like a PhD in vanity. I mean, he knew exactly where the light should be placed, where the camera should be placed. I mean, he was telling the greatest cinematographers of the era, Vittorio Storaro, Conrad Hall, Billy Fraker, yeah, where to put the camera, which was unheard of.
You said you met him first on the Dick Tracy set.
Yes.
Well, again, as you write the book, it is very funny. Madonna is referring to him as the old man.
Right.
And she is constantly putting him down. Interesting, and yet, as you describe it, how it was the concept of the picture in primary colors.
Well, yes, the picture was done in bright reds, green, yeah, yellows, blues, that sort of thing. That was part of, you know, it's a very, in some sense, expressionistic and interesting picture. I mean, Dick Tracy has been criticized a lot for wooden performances, but I think it's a really fascinating movie, and nobody but Beatty, I mean, he really reinvented the comic book movie. And
well, my husband directed the original Batman movie.
Okay.
That was the predecessor to that.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Well, okay. Well, that was, Dick Tracy came in out in the shadow,
yeah,
of that movie, and when it grossed $100 million, everyone said, well, it didn't do as good, didn't do as well as Batman.
Yeah.
You know? But I think the relationship with Madonna and what you point out is interesting, because she did make fun of him and she did call him old man, and I think it sort of dramatized for him that he couldn't keep living this sort of bachelor life forever.
Yeah.
And I think she sort of paved the way for Annette Bening, because by the time Annette came along, he was primed to get married.
Or no, have a baby first.
Or have
he said
a baby
to her,
first.
"Will you have my child or baby?" And she said, "Yes." He said, "Are you serious?" She says to him, "Are you serious?" Now, the dialogue in this book is terrific. I don't know, Peter, how much is Peter, how much is actual of what people said?
Well, a lot of it is what people said. I mean, first of all, these people are movie people, you know, and they're used to reading and writing script and acting scripts. So, mm-hmm, a lot of them speak in dialogue. You know, I mean, in other words, they sound,
yeah,
like script. You know, they're telling a story. They'll replicate the dialogue of, you know, however part people are.
He
parts
said to
there.
Me.
He
she said,
to,
said
you know, I
yeah.
said that. She said that. So a lot of it is actual verbatim from what these people have told me. The part of the dialogue which isn't is my dramatizing basically,
yeah,
what they said. I mean, none of it is made up, God knows.
I
God
have
forbid.
To say, too, that every chapter begins almost like, well, an Elizabethan or an English novel. So that when we get to the end, he's been up so long, it looks like down to me. Chapter 14. How Beatty made a virtue out of necessity when he plunged into family life after he became virtually unbankable. That's a great one. Then there's one about his going to Washington that is really quite wonderful, because he couldn't ever make up his mind.
True. I mean, he was a very, very fortunate man. I mean, both genetically speaking,
yeah,
you know, he was extremely handsome, even pretty, you know, beautiful.
Androgynous,
almost. Almost androgynous.
Yeah.
But he was also extremely intelligent. And But nobody's perfect, and you know, he had his neuroses, God knows, and one of them was that it was difficult for him to make up his mind, and he would canvass everybody in the neighborhood. I mean, he would turn to everyone around him and say, what do you think, what do you think, what do you think? And then he would ignore them, or he would, some people said he would take the, you know, he would repeat the opinion of the last person he spoke to.
It's interesting too, which the part I love, he's a reader. He loves to read.
He does love to read. He dropped out of college after a year, but he is an omnivorous reader and was, an auto, like a lot of those directors who didn't graduate from, left college because they were creative and college really wasn't for them. But he was an autodidact and he taught himself, and not just, he read a lot. I mean, he's an incredible medical diagnostician, amateur diagnostician, you know, and he diagnosed Hal Ashby's illness.
Oh, that's some story, mm-hmm. Yeah.
Other things.
And sent him off to Johns Hopkins, I believe, and paid for his operation, which unfortunately didn't work.